final speaker this morning is Ms. Soraya Mire.
Thank you. It's good to be here supporting that America, protecting children. Today I come to you not as a victim. Can you hear me? I speak very soft in my accent, very. Today I come to you not as a victim, but as a survivor, a woman who's not defined by what was taken from her for what she did, but what was left of her. As a survivor of the most horrendous act of female genital mutilation, I'm bothered by hearing the slowing sound of the sewing machine. How to speak so. They take me back to the days when I would watch my family tailor shop. My family tailor cutting off the long sleeves from my dress. He would adjust his glasses with his foot, push the panel to the floor. The loud noise would hurt my head, and instead of seeing the dress, I would feel the wild needle biting my skin. How can a mother prepare her child to go through the unthinkable, the terror of a culture that gone wrong? How can you prepare a child to wake up with the cruel hands firmly grabbing and spreading her life open and cutting? How can you prepare a child to go through the practice which violates their basic human rights? Many parts in Africa, it's believed that when children are born, they're born with both elements of sex, like the clitoris, which is considered in girls, the male element, the maleness, that tiny piece of flesh that people scare the most of it, that they feel without cutting that, it might grow longer, dangle, and she might have a third leg. Has to be cut off in order to properly set her right of initiation, her gender. For the male, the foreskin, that's what is seen as the maleness, and that soft side of him needs to be cut off in order to properly set his warrior side, the one who might be facing the lions who will be carrying the family trouble. I remember that fateful morning when my mother came to me and said that she was going to buy me a gift. I remember getting a little bit cocky and, you know, like really arrogant, thinking about all the scenes I was writing in my head, what, how my brothers and sister would look at me when I come back with this gorgeous dress, colorful one, and like always looking elegant when I say, look, I'm the chosen one, look at my mother, got me. But later when I found out what was about to happen, I remember crying to my mother, like, you're going to come my third leg. And she goes, her response was, yeah, this is my gift to you. It's time to become a woman. I wanted to run away, but where are you going to go? This is the one person who's supposed to protect you. She's my mother, after all. And I had no strength or energy to move my legs. I was only 13 years old, raised a very good life, a very government life. That's one thing that makes you equal, this mutilation. And I watched, shockingly, a young girl who's been cut out, brought this room. You could see trying to cry, but there's nothing. The arrow stuck inside. She couldn't even scream. She lost her voice. And I looked up and I saw the nurse rushing. This was a doctor's house, because when you have money, you go to the doctor's house. Girls cannot be taken to the hospitals. Either it's the midwife sitting in the bushes somewhere with a cut glass, or it's in a hospital. Not a hospital, the doctor's home kind of looks like a hospital, proper and clean. The nurse was rushing toward me, and suddenly I felt like a hand around my neck, and that moment I saw the image of a scared lamb that was tied to our cotton tree, ready to be slaughtered for the feast that day. That's how you would feel, not being a being, honestly. And all I could do was shout, I don't want to become a woman. I don't want to be a woman. I want to be something else, just who I am. And the nurse tied my wrists and legs down to the surgical table. And hearing the sound of the scissors cutting my flesh, you really feel like your body is sitting on that roaring sewing machine that I saw that my family was tailor shop, because you can't imagine. You can't really imagine. I mean, don't even ask about my cries, like the hot water, like rising up like waves, you know, from the depth of your being. And you're just a child. And all you could do is like cry and cry and cry until you lose your voice. And, but this act of whether we call female genital mutilation or male cutting or male genital mutilation, whether it's a cultural and religious or personal choice, I think is nothing but a scar of betrayal. It really is a soul wound that you have touched that child the minute you cut it, that child. Whether you think an adult, the child might not feel the pain, but stuck in you. Whether they choose to speak for it or against it, it's there. I've been fighting for the past 30 years. I'm only 19 now. Seriously. You know, and I've been fighting a child abuse. This is the ultimate child abuse, as you heard me say many times. And the reason why I say it is that first cut, it's all you need. Violation of their rights. They have no voice to speak. You're supposed to be a mother and father, giving those voices and protecting those children. So I, Darren, for the past 30 years, chose to speak child abuse that is, in our case, handed down generation after generations, that was kind of protected by the word culture, as if it provides, you know, absolution, nothing but protection. But we, the activists and survivors who really went through this, we decided as we use our own stories, first to heal ourselves and try to find a way to say, I didn't ask for this, don't look at me. Still a woman. I'm still capable of everything you are. I didn't choose this, but I chose to say, no, you have to stop this. And that's what we've been doing, and I'm hopefully changed about that many times. But the reason why I'm a little bit nervous about this is like, if I remember, what I remember back in 1993, sitting at Marilyn Monroe's living room, watching that video of that young baby boy undergoing the genital mutilation, what struck me the most was his painful cry as his wrists and legs were tied down to the surgical table. I saw myself in him as my own mother stood above my head, eyes watching the doctor's rough fingers dancing around my private parts, touching a place he had no business touching. No business touching. And that's the reason why coming here not only helping me, America, but to say that no one has a right to touch the child down there. While taping a female genital mutilation show, Oprah Winfrey said to me, and I really like to say exactly what she said. I need glasses, but I'm okay. Oprah Winfrey, she asked me, she said what she didn't understand. She didn't understand why women don't just rise up and say, you can't do this to our daughters. We are not going to allow this to happen. That, Oprah said, she didn't understand. And that's what I'm asking today, America. Why don't you get up and say, you're not going to do this to our boys?